Hello all, so let's talk about a topic of GIT, that is drugs for constipation. Okay, so what happens in constipation in the colon or the large intestine? In the colon or in large intestine, the fecal matter becomes impacted. The stools or the fecal matter becomes impacted and it cannot move forward. Okay, so this leads to constipation. Now, the drugs which are used for the treatment of constipation, remember, they increase bowel or colon evacuation. Okay, they will cause bowel or colon evacuation. Because of this reason, this fecal matter will move forward. Okay, this fecal matter will move forward. Now, these drugs, they are known as the drugs which increases this bowel movement, they are known as laxatives. They are known as laxatives. Another name of laxatives is aperients. Aperients. Okay. Or sometimes they are also known as purgatives. And purgatives, they are also known as cathartics. They are also known as cathartics. These are the four names of these drugs which are used for the treatment of constipation. These are the four names. Okay, and what is the function of these drugs? These drugs, they will increase bowel evacuation or bowel movement, and the feces will move forward and it will be ejected out. The feces will be ejected out of the body. Now, there is a difference between a word laxative and purgative. Now, normally laxative means these drugs have a very mild action. They are very mild acting drug, so they very push this feces very slowly. Because of this reason, the feces which will come outside, these feces will be formed stools or formed feces. So they ejest formed feces. While purgatives, they are stronger drugs. Okay, purgatives, they are stronger drugs. Because of this reason, they cause rapid bowel evacuation, which can lead to ejection of watery stools. Lot of water will also be ejected out. But remember, both these terms are used interchangeably. We use both these terms interchangeably. Okay, we can use the term laxative, we can also use the term purgatives. So let's see first the classification of the drugs which are laxative. Okay, let's see what are the drugs we have among laxative or purgatives. So suppose this is the large intestine and there are feces. The first laxative we will write is known as bulk laxative. Okay, the first laxative we call them as bulk laxatives. Another name of bulk laxative, they are also known as dietary fibers. Okay, they are also known as dietary fibers. They are also known as prebiotics. They are also known as prebiotics. Okay, so let's see first what is their mechanism of action. These drugs, they will go into the intestine. Okay, they go into the intestine and they have a property that they absorb water on their surface. They absorb water on their surface. So water molecule will come on their surface. When the water molecule will come on their surface, their bulk will increase. Their bulk will increase. Due to increase in bulk, they cause stretching of intestine. The intestine or colon will stretch. Due to colon stretching, they will increase spontaneous, because when the colon will stretch, it will spontaneously start contracting. It will increase spontaneous muscle contraction. Okay, they will cause spontaneous muscle contraction. So let's see first what are the drugs we have. We will write the names of the drugs are bran, husk, psyllium. Psyllium is also known as plantago. Okay, espargula, which is sometimes known as isabgol, and lastly methyl cellulose. मिथाइल सेल्यूलोस. ओके, इन वन वर्ड व्हाट इज द केमिकल नेचर ऑफ दीज ड्रग. रिमेंबर दीज ड्रग्स आर अनडाइजेस्टेबल. दीज आर अनडाइजेस्टेबल कार्बोहाइड्रेट. दीज आर दोज कार्बोहाइड्रेट्स विच वी कैन नॉट डाइजेस्ट इन अवर बॉडी. हैंस दीज कार्बोहाइड्रेट विल नॉट एब्जॉर्ब इन टू द ब्लड. दे विल रिमेन इन द इंटेस्टीन एंड दे एब्जॉर्ब वॉटर ऑन देअर सर्फेस. सो दे आर अनडाइजेस्टेबल कार्बोहाइड्रेट लाइक एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ दोज कार्बोहाइड्रेट. सो दे आर द मिक्सचर ऑफ दिस काइंड ऑफ अ ड्रग लाइक सेल्यूलोस. सेल्यूलोस वी कैन नॉट डाइजेस्ट. लिग्निन्स, पेक्टिन्स एक्सेट्रा. ओके, सो दे आर अनडाइजेस्टेबल कार्बोहाइड्रेट. नाउ लेट्स सी वेयर दीज ड्रग्स आर यूज्ड. ओके, लेट्स सी फर्स्ट वेयर दीज ड्रग्स आर यूज्ड. ओके, एंड व्हाट इज देयर मैकेनिज्म ऑफ एक्शन. ओके, नाउ दीज ड्रग्स, रिमेंबर दे इंक्रीज स्पॉन्टेनियस मसल कॉन्ट्रैक्शन. दे इंक्रीज स्पॉन्टेनियस मसल कॉन्ट्रैक्शन ड्यू टू स्ट्रेचिंग ऑफ कोलोन. बिकॉज ऑफ दिस रीजन, रिमेंबर एज दे कॉज स्ट्रेचिंग ऑफ कोलोन, रिमेंबर दे आर एब्सोल्यूटली कॉन्ट्राइंडिकेटेड इन केसेस ऑफ जीआईटी अल्सर्स. इफ देर इज अल्सर्स इन द कोलोन, दे शुड नॉट बी गिवन बिकॉज एज दे आर कॉजिंग स्ट्रेचिंग, इट मे लीड टू परफोरेशन. सो बल्क लैक्सेटिव शुड नॉट बी गिवन इन केसेज ऑफ जी आई टी अल्सर्स. और सिमिलरली इन केसेज ऑफ जी आई टी एडहेशंस लाइक स्ट्रिक्चर्स आर फॉर्म्ड इन जी आई टी और कोलोन. ओके, सो दे शुड नॉट बी गिवन. सिमिलरली दे शुड नॉट बी गिवन इन अ कंडीशन नोन एज मेगा कोलोन. Because in megacolon, already the colon is very much stretched. Okay? Plus, remember, they also increase or stimulate the growth of bacterias. They stimulate the growth of good bacterias which are present in our intestine. That is why these drugs, they are also known as prebiotics. Pre means they will stimulate. Biotic means growth of bacteria. Okay? Okay, they will stimulate the growth of bacteria. Now the point is, remember these laxative, they are absolutely contraindicated if there is GIT infections. They should not be given in cases of GIT infection. Okay, now where these bulk laxatives are used, you will write these bulk laxatives, they are the drug of choice for overall all types of constipation. Overall constipation, they are the drug of choice or the first drug to be started. So let's see in which constipation they are the drug of choice. We will write they are the drug of choice for functional constipation. Functional means idiopathic. We don't know the cause. It is due to lifestyle. Okay. They are also the drug of choice for irritable bowel syndrome. They are the drug of choice for irritable bowel syndrome. And if there is irritable bowel syndrome, there is constipation. Constipation which is seen in irritable bowel syndrome. Now, why there is irritable bowel syndrome constipation is seen? Because there is spastic colon. The colon becomes irritable and it gets contracted again and again. Okay. So, if there is spastic colon, the drug of choice is bulk laxatives. Okay. Bulk laxatives are the drug of choice in spastic colon. Okay, the next point is they are also the drug of choice to prevent constipation in bedridden patient. Okay, and to prevent constipation in bedridden patient, they are also the drug of choice to prevent strain in abdomen. If a person has to provide strain at stool, to prevent strain at stools, suppose the patient has undergone abdominal surgery like cesarean section, patient is suffering from hernia, we maintain this patient chronically on bulk laxatives. Okay, bulk laxatives. So remember this part. Okay, so they should not be given. Now let's talk about the contraindication of these drugs. Where they should not, what are the side effects, sorry, What are the side effects of these drugs? The first side effect of these drugs are that they are very slow acting drug and they are very mild acting drug. They are not very strong acting drug. Okay, their effect will take at least 3 to 4 days to come. Their effect will come after 3 to 4 days. Second point, these dietary fibers are unpalatable. They are unpalatable. Patient cannot swallow it because they are undigestible. They are unpalatable. And the last point is their side effect is that they cause flatulence. Their main side effect is flatulence. Due to action of bacteria, flatulence or bloating. So the main side effect of bulk laxative is flatulence or bloating because of distension of colon. Because of distension of colon. Okay. So this is the first type of laxative we have, that is bulk laxative. So bulk laxative, they will increase the bulk of the intestine. Let's talk about now the second laxative. The second laxative we have is stimulant laxative. Stimulant laxative, they are also known as irritant laxative. Okay. Now let's see how they are different from bulk laxative. We know that bulk laxative, they were undigestible, they are not absorbed, and they were increasing the bulk. They were causing stretching. Stimulant laxative, they are given in very low dose. They go to this epithelial cells of intestine and go to the muscles. And go to the muscle. They directly stimulate these cells of muscles and intestinal epithelial cells. So suppose this is a muscle cell and epithelial cell. So these drugs, they directly stimulate muscle or epithelial cells. Now why they directly stimulate? Because they cause irritation. Irritation means they cause local inflammation out there. Because of their irritant nature or local inflammatory nature, the muscles and epithelial cell, they get stimulated. Now when the muscle will get stimulated, remember, they will increase active muscle contraction. It will increase active muscle contraction. So remember, bulk laxatives, they were causing spontaneous muscle contraction that was passive. It is causing active muscle contraction, and epithelial cells will start secreting fluid or water into the intestine. Epithelial cells will secrete water and the muscle will contract. Because of this reason, these drugs are very strong drug. These drugs are very strong drugs. Okay. So stimulant laxative as compared to bulk laxative, they cause active muscle contraction and hence they are very strong drug. Now you know that they may cause active muscle contraction. It can lead to spastic colon. It can lead to spasm of colon. Because of this reason, stimulant laxatives are absolutely contraindicated in spastic colon, which is seen in cases of irritable bowel syndrome. They are absolutely contraindicated in irritable bowel syndrome or spastic colon. And they are absolutely contraindicated if there is intestinal obstruction. If already there is intestinal obstruction, don't give them. The reason is they already cause spasm of colon. And remember, these drugs, they are absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. The reason is these drugs, they may cause increase in contraction of not only intestinal muscle, they may also increase the contraction of uterus, which may lead to abortion. Okay. So what is the use of stimulant laxative? The main use of stimulant laxative is they are given as a short-term measure. They are given as a short-term measure for acute bowel evacuation. When you suddenly want to evacuate the bowel, as a short-term measure, you can give this drug, like in cases of preparation of bowel, preparation of bowel or abdomen before surgery. Okay, before surgery, if you have to give, you have to make the bowel empty because you are doing abdominal surgery, or you are doing abdominal x-ray, or you are doing abdominal ultrasound, because you don't want that the fecal shadow should come. So before surgery, you want to make the bowel empty suddenly, we give bulk stimulant laxatives. Okay, stimulant laxatives. So let's see what are the drugs we have among stimulant laxatives. Okay, so the drugs among stimulant laxatives or irritant laxatives, they are divided into various types. Okay, the first class is based upon the chemical structure. The first class is diphenylmethane. This is the chemical nature, and you don't have to remember the name of diphenylmethane, but what are the drugs we have among diphenylmethane, that is very important. The drug, so these all are the example of stimulant or irritant laxative. Okay, the first one we have is bisacodyl. So bisacodyl is a very commonly used drug for acute bowel evacuation. Okay, acute bowel evacuation. We can also use other drugs like sodium picosulfate. Sodium picosulfate. And there was a drug phenolphthalein. But remember, phenolphthalein was a coloring dye. It has been banned now because it was causing colon cancers. Because of carcinogenic risk, it got banned. Hence, we have bisacodyl and sodium picosulfate. The next drug we have is anthrol pigment. These drugs, they are anthrol pigment. They have active ingredient anthrol, and this anthrol act as a stimulant laxative. The drug we have among them is senna, and senna is obtained from a plant known as cascara plant. Okay, it is obtained from a plant, cascara plant. Okay, now the third one we have is 5-HT4-agonist. These drugs, they stimulate serotonin receptor present on intestinal muscle. These drugs are also known as prokinetic. Okay, the drug name is prucalopride. Okay, and lastly we have certain oils like castor oil. Castor oil is obtained from the seeds of Ricinus communis. But remember, now castor oil is now not used. Just remember the word Ricinus. It is now not used. Okay, let's talk about prucalopride first. Where prucalopride is used? Prucalopride is used in resistant cases of idiopathic constipation. So it's a very safe drug. We know that the drug of choice for any constipation is bulk laxative. In resistant cases, we can give prucalopride. Okay. Now, senna nowadays is less preferred because the side effect of senna, you will write, senna causes melanosis coli. The side effect of senna is melanosis coli. It will cause blackening of large intestine. Okay. And bisacodyl and picosulfate, remember, they may cause, they are very strong drug, they may cause hypokalemia. But remember, hypokalemia is seen with all laxatives. All laxatives can cause hypokalemia because of increase in bowel activity, potassium is lost into the feces. Okay, all can cause hypokalemia. So these are the examples of the drugs we have among stimulant laxatives. Okay, stimulant laxative. You can also write that this bisacodyl specifically can cause various allergic reactions like Stevens-Johnson syndrome. SJS stands for Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Okay, Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Now let's talk about the third class of laxative. The third class of laxative that we have is known as osmotic laxative. Okay, osmotic laxatives. Now what osmotic laxative will do? Osmotic laxative, they will come into the colon and they will increase osmotic pressure. They will increase osmotic pressure. Because of osmotic pressure, the fluid will retain out here. Okay, the water will be retained out here. Water will come due to osmotic pressure. Because of this reason, they will push the feces. Suppose this is a feces, they will push the feces forward. So feces will be pushed by osmotic pressure. Okay, let's see what are the drugs we have among osmotic agents. Okay, the first you will write, we have magnesium salts. Magnesium salts, okay, like magnesium sulfate, magnesium hydroxide. Okay, magnesium sulfate, magnesium hydroxide. Okay, now this magnesium, remember, it is also used as an antacid also. Okay, now where magnesium is used, remember, magnesium is used for the treatment of acute constipation. If there is acute constipation, we can give magnesium salt. Now, what is the mechanism of action of magnesium? Magnesium increases the release of cholecystokinin. Magnesium increases the release of cholecystokinin, and cholecystokinin increases motility of intestine. Okay. Now, remember, magnesium salts are absolutely contraindicated in renal failure. Okay. Magnesium salts are absolutely contraindicated in renal failure. Now let's move forward. Okay, let's move forward. Let's talk about next drug, that is sodium salts. Sodium salts, like examples we can write as sodium sulfate, which is also known as Glauber salt. We have sodium phosphate, we have sodium potassium tartarate, it is also known as Rochelle salt. Okay, now very important point with sodium is, sodium salts are the fastest acting laxatives we have. Okay, the fastest acting laxatives we have is sodium salt, and they will produce effect within 1 to 3 hours. They can cause empty of bowel within 1 to 3 hours. Because of this reason, you will write that this sodium containing salts, they are also known as saline purgatives. Hence, sodium salts are also known as saline purgatives, and these saline purgatives, we will write, they are the drug of choice. They are the drug of choice for the poisoning of a drug. So if there is a drug poisoning, we can remove this drug in feces. They are also given in cases of helminthic infection, because sometimes this helminthics, they can obstruct our intestine. Helminthic infection, and they can also given for the treatment of acute constipation. They can given for the treatment of acute constipation. Okay, acute constipation. Let's see what are the other agents we have among osmotic laxative. The other agents we have among osmotic laxative are, the third one we will write is lactulose, mannitol, sorbitol. Okay, and glycerine. Okay, these lactulose, mannitol, sorbitol, we will write that sorbitol, mannitol, and they are undigestible sugars. Okay, now when they go to the intestine, remember, when they go to the intestine, these undigestible sugar, they are broken down two small fatty acids by the colonic bacteria. The bacteria which are present in colon, they break them down into small fatty acid, but they cannot be absorbed. Okay, they cannot be absorbed, and these small fatty acid, they increase osmotic pressure. Okay, now the first point is lactulose. Remember, when lactulose is broken down into small fatty acid, lactulose increases or makes the pH acidic. It increases acidity. It increases acidity of this intestine, or you will write it will decrease the pH of colon. Okay, it will decrease the pH of colon. Now the point is, where this lactulose is low, lactulose is the drug of choice for, among laxative, for the treatment of hepatic encephalopathy. Okay, hepatic encephalopathy, because lactulose increases the pH by giving acidic substance H+. Now the point is, why? Suppose this is an intestine, and in intestine, in our intestine there are bacteria. These bacteria, they form ammonia. Normally this ammonia comes into the blood and it goes to the liver, and it gets converted into a non-toxic substance, urea. Okay, liver converts it into urea. Now there is a disease known as hepatic encephalopathy. Hepatic encephalopathy occurs when there is liver failure, when the liver is not functioning. That condition is known as cirrhosis of liver. It occurs in cases of cirrhosis of liver. What happens in cirrhosis of liver, this ammonia cannot be converted into urea, and this ammonia can go into the brain, and in brain it may cause brain damage, which is lead to encephalopathy. It can lead to encephalopathy. So what we have to do, lactulose will donate H+ by making the pH of intestine acidic, and this ammonia will be converted into ammonium. This ammonium is water soluble, that means it is ionic, and remember, this ammonium cannot be reabsorbed. Ammonium cannot absorb into blood. Okay, so lactulose converts. Why we give lactulose in hepatic encephalopathy? Because lactulose convert ammonia into ammonium, and ammonium is water soluble or ionic, it cannot be reabsorbed into the blood. Hence lactulose is the drug of choice for hepatic encephalopathy. What about other drugs? If you talk about mannitol, sorbitol and glycerin, remember they are given in cases of, in, they are given as enemas. They can be given as enemas. Okay, for bowel irrigation. They can be given as enema for bowel irrigations. So these are the drugs we have among osmotic laxatives. Let's move forward. Let's talk about the fourth class of drug, that is stool softeners. So this is now the fourth class of drug after osmotic laxative, stool softeners. Now stool softener, what they will be doing? Stool softeners, they are oily substance. Okay, they emulsify stools, and the stools will become soft. So the consistency of the stool will become greasy or soft. Okay, and if the stools will become oily or if soft, it can be easily passed without strain. It can easily be passed without strain. Okay, so it can easily be passed without strain. So let's see what are the drugs we have among stool softener. There are only two drugs we have among stool softener. The first drug we have is DOS. The first drug we have among stool softener is docusate. Okay, docusate. Now docusate is also known as DOS. It is also known as DOS. DOS stands for dioctyl sodium sulfosuccinate. So it's a kind of an oily substance or a fatty substance. Okay, it has a oily action. Okay, so where it is given? When the straining of stool should be avoided. Like example, it is given in cases of pregnancy. Docuset can be given in pregnancy. Why? Because in pregnancy, straining can be harmful sometimes. Second is mineral oils like liquid paraffin. Okay, so it is also an oily or petroleum product. Okay, oily or petroleum product. But remember, now this liquid paraffin has been banned. It is now not used. Why it is not used? Because if it can get absorbed into the lymph, it gets absorbed into lymph. And when it gets absorbed into the lymph, remember, it can lead to foreign body granuloma. It can cause inflammation known as foreign body granuloma. And sometimes a person can aspirate it. It can be a reflux back into the, when the patient is swallowing, it can aspirate into lungs. And in lungs, it can lead to lipid pneumonia. Because there is oily substance, oily are also known as lipid, it can lead to lipid pneumonia. And they are now not used because they may cause ulcers. Mineral oils can cause ulcer, hence mineral oil nowadays we don't use. Okay, it may cause ulcers. Okay, so let's move forward. Now the fifth class of drug we have among laxative is known as chloride secretors. They are known as chloride secretors. Okay, so they will increase chloride secretion. They are also known as prosecretory laxatives. They are also known as prosecretory laxatives. Now what these laxatives will do, suppose this is intestine and this is the intestinal epithelial cells. They will directly go to this epithelial cells and they will tell to release chloride ion into this. So with chloride, other fluid molecules will also come and fluid will increase the consistency and bulk so that easily the stools can be passed out. Okay, chloride secretors. So let's see what are the drugs we have among chloride secretors. The first drug we have among chloride secretor is very important drug for you, that is lubiprostone. The first drug we have is lubiprostone. Now what is this lubiprostone? As you are seeing, prost word is coming. Lubiprostone is a prostaglandin E1 analog. It is prostaglandin E1 analog. It goes to the intestinal cells. It goes to the epithelial cells of intestine and act on a prostaglandin receptor known as EP4 receptor. And this EP4 receptor increases cyclic AMP, and this cyclic AMP increases chloride secretion. Okay, it increases chloride secretion. Now where this lubiprostone is used, lubiprostone is the drug of choice in constipation predominant irritable bowel syndrome. Now remember, it is not the first drug to be started. It is given in constipation, which is seen in irritable bowel syndrome. Only it is given in resistant cases. It is only given in resistant cases. Remember, the drug of choice for constipation predominant irritable bowel syndrome is bulk laxatives. Okay, bulk laxatives. Okay, so this is lubiprostone. Now the second class of drug we have is linaclotide and a similar drug, plicanatide. Okay, linaclotide and plicanatide, remember, their structure is just like soluble guanyl cyclase. They are soluble guanyl cyclase. And soluble guanyl cyclase, they will directly go to the intestine and stimulate cyclic GMP enzyme. So it is stimulating cyclic AMP. It will stimulate cyclic GMP. Cyclic GMP will directly release chloride ion from the intestine. Okay. So it directly stimulates cyclic GMP inside the epithelial cells of intestine. Now where this linaclotide and plicanatide is used, it has been approved in idiopathic constipation. But remember, in resistant cases only. So these drugs, chloride secretors, are used in resistant cases. It is also given in constipation, which is seen in irritable bowel syndrome. And it is also given in the constipation, which is due to constipation due to opioids. Opioids induced constipation. But remember, they are given in resistant cases only. So these are the new drugs which are chloride secretors. So in chloride secretor, we have lubiprostone, given in constipation seen in irritable bowel syndrome to treat constipation, linaclotide and plicanatide, many other uses as well. Now let's talk about certain miscellaneous drugs for the treatment. So the first drug we will write among miscellaneous, the first drug is one defoaming agent. Okay, defoaming agent. The name of the drug is methyl polysiloxane. Okay. Now, what is this drug? Remember, this drug, methyl polysiloxane, if it is present in intestine, remember, it will have a detergent-like action and it will burst bubbles. It will burst bubbles. Hence, it is used for the treatment of flatulence. Or, in simple word, in the patient word, for the treatment of gas. Okay, the gases which are formed due to fermentation of bacteria, defoaming agent. Second class of drug we have is cholinergic drugs. They will increase acetylcholine level. Example of cholinergic drugs are, you'll write neostigmine increases acetylcholine level in the intestine. And acetylcholine increases intestinal motility. And the next is bethanicol. Bethanicol will directly act on acetylcholine receptor. So it is, the receptor of acetylcholine is muscarinic. It is muscarinic or M3 receptor agonist. Okay. So they will directly go to the intestine and act on muscle, and the muscle will contract. Where they are given? They are given in cases of post-operative paralytic ileus. Okay, if there is post-operative paralytic ileus, they are given. Okay, and they are also given in the treatment of megacolone. They are also given in the treatment of megacolone. So these drugs also increase intestinal motility. And last point, we have the drugs for treatment of opioid induced constipation. So for the full detail, you can refer to the chapter of opioid CNS. Okay, but let's recapitulate certain drugs. Remember, opioids are the drugs like morphine, codeine. The side effect of opioid is constipation. Opioids, remember, they cause constipation by acting on three receptors known as mu, kappa, delta. These are the three receptors of opioid which causes constipation. They reduce intestinal motility. Hence, for the treatment of opioid induced constipation, we have made opioid antagonist. We block these receptors. We will block these receptors of opioid. So let's see what are the drugs. All these drugs, remember, are given orally. And all these drugs are non-addictive drugs. All these drugs will be non-addictive. So the drugs are naloxone. What is naloxone? Naloxone is mu कप्पा एंड डेल्टा एंटागनिस्ट, इट विल ब्लॉक ऑल द रिसेप्टर्स ऑफ ओपियॉइड, म्यू कप्पा एंड डेल्टा एंटागनिस्ट. लेट्स मूव फॉरवर्ड, व्हाट आर द अदर ड्रग्स, वी विल राइट नेलोक्सीजोल. ओके, मिथाइल नाइट्रिक्सोन, एंड लास्टली नेल डी मिडीन, नेल मी डिप नेल नेल डी मिडीन. ऑल दीज ड्रग्स आर सिमिलर ड्रग. ओके, नाउ वी हैव मेड अ न्यू ड्रग. दैट न्यू ड्रग इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट ड्रग फॉर यू, एलवी मो पान. एंड दिस क्वेश्चन इज आस्क फ्रॉम यू हाउ टू रिमेंबर. एज यू आर सींग एम वर्ड इज कमिंग, एम फॉर इट इज म्यू, ओपी वर्ड इज कमिंग ओपियॉइड, ए एन वर्ड इज कमिंग एंटागनिस्ट. सो इट विल ओनली ब्लॉक म्यू रिसेप्टर ऑफ ओपियॉइड. वाइल दीज ड्रग नैलोक्सोन, नैलोजिक्सॉल, नैल्ट्रिक्सॉन, नैलमीडीन, दे ऑल आर दे ब्लॉक ऑल द रिसेप्टर. Hence, they are used in the treatment of opioid-induced constipation. Okay, so these are the drugs we have for the treatment of constipation. Okay, so thank you very much. Hello all. So now let's discuss about the treatment or the drugs for diarrhea. Okay, now what is the definition of diarrhea? According to WHO, the definition of diarrhea is passage of too frequent passage of poorly formed stools. Okay, poorly formed stools. So how much should be the frequency? So remember, it is defined if the person is passing at least three or more than three stools, watery stools per day in 24 hours or per day. Okay, in 24 hours. So if a person is passing more than three watery stools per day, is considered as a diarrhea. Okay, now the point is, what could be the cause of this diarrhea? It can lead to, remember, it could be due to secretory diarrhea, it could be due to infectious diarrhea. There are many causes of diarrhea that we will be discussing shortly. Okay, so what is the main management of diarrhea? Let's discuss how to treat this diarrhea. Okay, the first management principle of the treatment of diarrhea is to give fluid replacement, fluid and electrolyte replacement. Okay, fluid and electrolyte replacement, along with we should maintain nutritional status. Okay, maintain nutrition also, so that the patient shouldn't have any nutritional deficiency. Okay, fluid and electrolyte replacement. Second point is drugs for diarrhea. Okay, drugs for diarrhea. So drugs for diarrhea, they will be divided into many types that we will be discussing shortly. Okay, how to stop this diarrhea. So let's talk about how do we see manage the fluid and electrolyte replacement which has been lost. Okay, but before right here, the drugs which we used in the diarrhea, they are divided into many types. Okay, the first one you will write, we use certain antibiotics or antimicrobial, especially in cases of infective diarrhea. Okay, we also use probiotics, we also use anti motility drug. Okay, we also use anti-secretory drugs, and lastly we also use adsorbent drug. So these are the five classes of drugs we use for the treatment of diarrhea. Okay, antimicrobial, they will kill the harmful bacteria or infection. Probiotics are the good bacteria which are present in our intestine. Antimotility will reduce the motility of the intestine. Okay, so it will reduce the motility or peristaltic activity. Antisecretory will reduce the fluid loss, and adsorbent will increase the fecal volume, that we will discuss shortly. So these are the main treatment we give for the treatment. These are the various drugs we give for the treatment of diarrhea. So let's start with the first one, that is fluid replacement, fluid or electrolyte replacement in diarrhea. Okay, so in the first management of diarrhea, we will write fluid and electrolyte replacement. Okay, now the first point is we can give intravenous fluid. We can give intravenous fluid. That intravenous fluid of replacement in diarrhea is known as Dhaka fluid. Okay, it is known as Dhaka fluid. And intravenous fluid replacement should be given if there is more than 10% of body weight. 10% of the body weight fluid loss is seen. If the fluid which has been lost is more than 10% of the body weight, then we must start intravenous fluid. What is the composition of Dhaka fluid? Remember, Dhaka fluid contains sodium chloride, potassium chloride, and sodium bicarbonate. Sodium bicarbonate. Okay, and they must be dissolved in 1 liter of 5% dextrose. 5% dextrose. Now what, how much molecules of sodium chloride we must dissolve? We will write 85 nanomoles. Potassium chloride, 13 nanomoles. And sodium bicarbonate, 48 nanomoles. So this is the composition of Dhaka fluid. Now let's talk about oral. The oral fluid, oral replacement is known as, this is the most important part, that is known as ORS. ORS stands for oral rehydration salt. Oral rehydration salt. Now remember, oral rehydration salt should also be dissolved. One packet of this salt should be dissolved in 1 liter of water. 1 liter of pure water. Okay. Now let's see what is the composition of ORS we have. Composition. Okay. Now, if you talk about the older variety of ORS, that older variety of ORS which was made by WHO was known as, it was known as standard WHO ORS formula. Okay, so this older variety. Okay, standard WHO ORS formula. Now this formula of ORS, remember, it was based on the stools of cholera diarrhea, cholera stools. The fluid and electrolyte which are lost in cholera stools, we replenish or we replace with that part. So it contained various constituents, like it was having sodium, it was having potassium chloride, citrate, and glucose. What was the composition? The sodium was 90 millimoles. Okay, potassium was 20 millimoles, chloride was 80 millimoles, citrate 10 millimoles, and glucose was 111 millimoles. Okay, 111 millimoles. If you see the total osmolarity, if you will add up it will become 311 millimoles, and this must be dissolved in 1 liter of water. 1 liter of water. So this standard WHO formula was based upon the stools of cholera diarrhea. Okay, but now remember, we have made a new WHO now has replaced this standard WHO formula with a new ORS formula. So now WHO has made new ORS formula, and this new ORS formula is based upon, it is based upon ETEC diarrhea. It is based upon ETEC diarrhea. ETEC stands for enterotoxigenic E. coli diarrhea. Okay, so if you see the composition or the content, if we see the composition or the content of these concentration, we will see the concentration of the sodium. The concentration of the sodium here has become now 75 millimoles. The concentration of potassium has become 20, same. Chloride 65, citrate 10, and glucose again 75, similar to sodium, okay, millimoles. So this is the formula of new ORS formula, which is based upon ETEC diarrhea. It is based upon ETEC diarrhea. Now, if you see the total osmolarity comes out to be 250 millimoles per liter of solution. In 1 liter, we have to dissolve it. Okay. Now, the point is, if we see the difference, before coming to the difference, we must write how we make it. We add sodium chloride. Okay. We add sodium chloride. If we see the content, we add sodium chloride. We add potassium chloride salt, we add trisodium citrate, and we add glucose. So by mixing these chemicals, we can obtain how much sodium we should mix. We will write 2.6 grams. Potassium chloride 1.5 grams. Trisodium citrate 2.5 grams. Okay. And glucose, it should be 13.5 grams. 13.5 grams. Okay, I'm really sorry. Trisodium citrate, just a moment. Okay. trisodium citrate is 2.9 grams. Please make it 2.9 grams. Okay. 2.9 grams. So this is the overall. So this is the overall. So if you will add up it, it will come out to be 11, 20, 25, 20.5 grams. Okay, it will come out to be 25 point grams. So that is irrelevant. You have to remember just the concentration. Now, let's see what is the difference between this content. As you can see from the standard ORS formula and this new WHORS formula, we have reduced the content of sodium. We have reduced the content of sodium to 75. Now the point is why? Because in this standard ORS formula, the content of sodium was high. So if this sodium standard ORS formula in the patient of ETEC diarrhea, in the patient of ETEC, it was producing hypernatremia. It was producing hypernatremia, and due to hypernatremia, the patients were developing periorbital edema. So remember, high sodium causes edema. It leads to periorbital edema. So that is why we have reduced the content of sodium. Okay, earlier it was 90, now we had made it 75. Okay, now let's see what is the role of each of this constituent. Okay, what is the role of these all these constituent? Okay, why we give sodium, why we give potassium, and why we give chloride? We will write to replenish electrolyte loss. To replenish electrolyte loss. Why we give trisodium citrate? There are two main role of trisodium citrate. Trisodium citrate first is given to correct acidosis. It is given to correct acidosis, which is seen in cases of dehydration. And the second point, this trisodium citrate, the citrate which is present out here, citrate increases absorption of sodium. Citrate increases absorption of sodium and potassium, other electrolyte. Okay. And now the last part is, why we add glucose? Remember, we don't add glucose for energy. Remember, glucose is added to increase the absorption of sodium from intestine. Okay, because remember, in intestine there is a channel that is known as sodium glucose cotransporter. So if you will add glucose, glucose increases the absorption of sodium from the intestine, and this is the basis of adding glucose, becomes the basis of success of ORS in the treatment of diarrhea. So glucose is mainly added because it increases the absorption of sodium into the blood. Okay, so these are the three points we must remember. Now just remember, before giving citrate, earlier instead of citrate earlier we were using sodium bicarbonate, but nowadays we don't give bicarbonate. The reason is, this bicarbonate has very short shelf life. The shelf life is very short. That means it can be stored for very short duration of time, and this bicarbonate turns the color of ORS into brown color. It can lead to brown coloration. So the color will change. So it will appear not good. Okay. The color will also change. Now the next point you write, recently WHO and Indian Academy of Pediatrics, they have recommended that with ORS one must give zinc supplementation also. For at least 10 to 14 days. Okay. So with zinc, ORS zinc supplementation separately must be given. Now how much zinc supplementation should be given? Zinc must be given 20 milligram for the children of 6 months to 5 years per day. Okay, per day it should be given 20 milligram, and it should be given 10 milligram for the children of 0 to 6 months if they suffer from diarrhea per day. Okay, now what is the basis of adding zinc? Remember, what when we have added zinc to this ORS in the ORS patient, what we have seen, that zinc, it reduces the frequency of diarrhea. Zinc reduces the frequency of diarrhea. Zinc also reduced the recurrence of diarrhea. Again, diarrhea was not occurring for at least 2 to 3 months. Zinc reduced the frequency and recurrence, and again occurring of diarrhea has been reduced by zinc. Now what is the mechanism of action of zinc? Although it is not fully proven, but remember, zinc, it increases mucosal growth. If there is more mucosal growth in the intestine, it will lead to better absorption of fluid and electrolyte. Zinc also increases immunity of the body, and zinc also decreases secretion of fluid into the feces. So it will decrease fluid loss. It will reduce fluid loss. The proposed mechanism is, zinc decreases cyclic AMP level. Cyclic AMP causes fluid loss. Okay. So these are the proposed mechanism. So this is the reason of ORS. This is the all composition of ORS that you must remember. Okay. Now let's talk about, so this is about fluid replacement. Let's come to the next therapy. The next therapy, let's talk about the drugs for diarrhea. Okay. Let's talk about drugs for diarrhea. So the first point is antimicrobial in the treatment of diarrhea. Let's make a heading. Antimicrobials in the treatment of diarrhea. That whether to give this antibiotics or not. Now remember, in which scenarios we will give antibiotic, in which scenario we will not give. Remember, antimicrobial, they should not be given. They have no value, or that means they should not be given in certain scenario. Remember, in certain scenarios they can be given as a reserve drug. Reserve drug means they should be given only in severe cases. They should be given only in severe cases. And lastly, there are certain infections in which antimicrobials are mandatory to give. That means they should be regularly prescribed in certain cases of diarrhea. Okay, so let's see in which diarrhea antimicrobials should not be used. Remember, antimicrobials should not be given in celiac disease or celiac sprue, which is also known as gluten enteropathy. In gluten enteropathy, we don't give antimicrobial for the treatment of diarrhea. Antimicrobials should also not be given in irritable bowel syndrome if there is diarrhea. Irritable bowel syndrome. Okay. They are also not given in tropical sprue. Okay. They should not be given in the patient having pancreatic deficiency, pancreatic enzyme deficiency. Okay. And lastly, they should not be given in the patient of hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis, because in thyrotoxicosis patient also have diarrhea. So in these diarrheas, remember, patient should not receive antimicrobial. Okay, now antimicrobials should not be given in diarrheas, but they are given only in cases of severe disease. Okay, you'll write not in mild disease. Not in mild cases we will not give antimicrobial. Okay, because antimicrobial will kill the good bacteria which are present in our intestine, but they are given only in severe case. Only in severe cases. So let's see in which severe cases we must give antimicrobial. The first point is traveler's diarrhea. Remember, in traveler's diarrhea normally we don't give antimicrobial, but in severe cases of traveler's diarrhea, if there is massive fluid loss, we give. Okay, okay. Like ETEC diarrhea, enterotoxigenic E. coli, or you will write non-invasive type. So only in severe cases you will prescribe antimicrobial. Okay, severe cases. So what is the drug of choice in ETEC diarrhea in severe cases? We will give rifaximin. We will give rifaximin as a drug. Okay, similarly, we can give rifaximin only in cases of severe cases of hepatic encephalopathy. Hepatic encephalopathy only in severe cases, not in mild. In mild cases we give lactulose. Okay, lactulose. Let's go talk about now next one, that is enteropathogenic E. coli, EPEC diarrhea. You'll write Shigella. Invasive Shigella. We'll write Yersinia. Enterocolitica diarrhea. Okay. In this case, we must give an antimicrobial. The drug of choice is cotrimoxazole. Okay. But you can give other drugs as well. Like, you can give fluoroquinolones. Like ciprofloxacin, norfloxacin. Okay, you can also give ampicillin. You can also give colistin. Okay, colistin. Thirdly, we will write, okay, Shigella enteritis. This is Shigella dysentery, but we will write non-invasive. enteritis and non salmonella bacteria. Here the drug of choice is fluoroquinolones. Okay, fluoroquinolones like ciprofloxacin, norfloxacin, etc. Okay, now if you talk about in which infections antimicrobial must be mandatory, so let's talk about mandatory. Antimicrobials are mandatory in certain infective diarrhea. In which infective diarrhea? We will write the first one. It is mandatory to give antimicrobial. The first is cholera, caused by Vibrio cholerae. Okay. Now remember, the drug of choice for cholera has now become azithromycin. Okay. Or you can use erythromycin, but more preferred is azithromycin. Okay. And remember, azithromycin is safe in children less than 8 years of age. It is also safe in pregnancy. Okay. You can also use a drug, doxycycline. But remember, doxycycline is contraindicated in children as well as in pregnancy. That is why erythromycin and azithromycin are the best drug for treatment of cholera. Okay. The next infection where it is mandatory, we will write Campylobacter jejuni. It is mandatory. The drug of choice is, again, you will write the drug of choice is, you will write first is norfloxacin. But remember, norfloxacin is also contraindicated in children and in pregnancy. Hence, in those cases, the drug of choice is azithromycin or erythromycin. In children and pregnancy, you will give azithro or erythromycin. Okay, in children and pregnancy. Third, we will write Clostridium difficile infection. Clostridium difficile causes one infection known as pseudomembranous colitis. Now here, in mild cases and in children, the drug of choice is metronidazole. Okay, but in severe cases and in resistant cases of metronidazole, the drug of choice is oral vancomycin. And remember, overall the drug of choice now is vancomycin. It is now considered as an overall drug of choice. That is vancomycin. Okay, so for the treatment of Clostridium difficile, please refer to antimicrobial videos. Okay, vancomycin video, where we have discussed all the details of treatment of Clostridium difficile infection. Now, fourth point is, it is mandatory to give antimicrobial in protozoan infection. Okay, protozoan infection. Okay, like amebiasis, giardiasis, etc. And remember, the drug of choice in these cases is metronidazole. So please refer to the videos of the whole treatment of amebiasis and giardiasis. So this is the antimicrobial which must be given. Now the next class of drug which we give in the treatment of diarrhea are probiotics. Okay. Probiotics. Now, what are probiotics? Probiotics, they are the live bacterias. And remember, these are the symbiotic bacterias or the good bacterias which are present in our intestine. Okay. So, they are the good bacterias which are found in our intestine. Remember, these good bacterias, they inhibit the growth of harmful bacterias as well. Okay, so what are the examples of those bacteria which we give? The examples we will write are Lactobacillus. Okay, Lactobacillus, Bifidobacterium, okay, Streptomyces, and Enterococcus. But remember, we also give one yeast also, a fungi. We also give one fungi also. That fungi name is Saccharomyces. We also give Saccharomyces also. So in the left side, these are the examples of bacteria, and this is a fungi also which we give. Okay. Now, what is the indication of giving these probiotics or the good bacteria? What is the indication? The major indication is when these good bacteria are killed. When these good bacteria are killed, these good bacteria are killed in cases of antibiotic associated diarrhea. If there is overuse of antibiotic and that antibiotic has killed this normal good bacteria, we give this probacteria. Okay, it is also given in pseudomembranous colitis, because in pseudomembranous colitis a harmful bacteria grows, Clostridium difficile. These good bacteria will replace those harmful bacteria. Pseudomembranous colitis, it is mandatory to give them in neonatal, because in neonate there are no bacteria in our intestine. Because of this reason, this intestine can get damaged. These bacteria are protective for intestine, so that disease is known as necrotizing. That means intestine is getting damaged. Enterocolitis. Entero means small intestine, colitis means large intestine. So it must be given in neonatal enterocolitis. And in all those conditions where we were not giving antimicrobial, okay, so it must be given in, you'll write, celiac disease. So all those conditions where we were not giving antimicrobial, so let's see these conditions. Okay, in these conditions we were not giving antimicrobial, we will be giving probiotics. Okay, so you can write those part out here. So in this condition we give probiotics. Okay, so here we give in celiac disease, we give in irritable bowel syndrome, in tropical sprue, okay, in pancreatic enzyme deficiency it must be given, in thyrotoxicosis. Okay, so remember, so these are the conditions of probiotics. Okay, now remember, these probiotics, they should not be confused with, they should not be confused with a word known as prebiotics. Sir, prebiotics is different, probiotics is different. So let's see what is the difference between pre and probiotics. So probiotics, we know they are the good bacteria or good microbes which are replacing the harmful one. So these are the good bacteria, probiotics. Now what is prebiotics? Prebiotics are the dietary fibers. Prebiotics are the dietary fibers, or you'll write cellulose like compound. Okay, which we cannot digest. And remember, when they go into the intestine, remember, they increase the growth of good bacteria. They increase the growth of good bacteria. Okay, why they cause growth of good bacteria? Because when they go to the intestine, they remain in the intestine for long duration of time, and they adsorb water on their surface. That is why these prebiotics are also known as adsorbents. They are also known as adsorbent, because when they go to the intestine, they stick water to their surface and they will remain there for long duration of time. And these cellulose or dietary fibers which we cannot digest, these good bacteria can digest. So these good bacteria, they can digest it. Because of this reason, these good bacteria, their growth will increase. Okay, so probiotics, we are giving good bacteria from outside, but prebiotics will increase the growth of good bacteria which is already present in our intestine. Okay, already present in our intestine. Okay, So remember this part. Now the second point, you are right that this prebiotics and probiotics, generally we combine them because prebiotics are increasing the growth of good bacteria and their combination is known as symbiotics. This combination is known as symbiotics. So prebiotics, they increase the growth of good bacteria. Okay, so the examples of prebiotics, you will write these drugs we have also discussed in the treatment of constipation. Okay, they are known as dietary fibers. So you can write bran, husk, psyllium. Psyllium is also known as plantago or metamucil. It is also known as metamucil. Okay, one of the safest drug in pregnancy is psyllium. Okay, then you can write other like methyl cellulose, aspergula. So these are the dietary fibers. Remember, they are given for the treatment of both diarrhea and they are given for the treatment of both constipation also. They are given for the treatment of constipation also, both. Okay, so we will discuss them. So this is the difference between prebiotics and postbiotics. Now the next class of drug we have among treatment of diarrhea. Let's see what are the different class of drug which we were discussing. The next class of drug we have for the treatment of diarrhea are antimotility, antisecretory and adsorbent. Adsorbents are known as prebiotics only. Okay, so now we have three classes of drug which are left. Okay, so adsorbents are what? Adsorbents are prebiotics. So we will not discuss this drug any further. Okay, so let's discuss about antimotility and antisecretory drug. Now let's see what is the difference. Antimotility drug, they will go to the muscle. They will go to the muscle and they will decrease motility. And if the motility is reduced, they will decrease peristaltic activity. If peristalsis is reduced, the fluid will not be lost. Okay. But about antisecretory, antisecretory drug, they will inhibit the secretion of fluid from epithelial cells. Okay. So antisecretory, they will inhibit the secretion of fluid from epithelial cell. Antimotility, they will reduce the motility by inhibiting the muscles of the intestine. Okay. So let's talk about the first one, that is antimotility drugs. Okay. Antimotility drug, remember, they reduce peristaltic activity. Because of this reason, the intestine will not contract and it will lead to reduced fluid loss. It will reduce fluid loss. Remember, ORS, if we have discussed ORS does not decrease fluid loss. ORS is just for replacement of fluid loss. While antimotility drug, they will directly reduce the fluid loss. But you have to remember a point out here, that these antimotility drugs, remember, they are absolutely contraindicated in infective diarrhea. They should not be given in infective diarrhea. The reason is, as the fluid is passing outside, the harmful infection is also moving outside. If with the fluid of diarrhea infection is moving outside, we don't want to suppress this motility. Because if we will suppress the motility, the infection will increase within the body. So they should not be given in infective diarrhea. Example, in invasive infectious diarrhea, those infection which generally invade intestinal muscles, which can damage intestine and come into the blood, we should not give in those diarrhea. They are absolutely contraindicated. Okay, so they should not be given. So they are generally given for non-infective diarrhea. Okay, and remember, what is their use? They are given as a short-term measure. To reduce fluid loss. To reduce fluid loss. Okay, so they are not given for long duration of time. They're just given as a short-term measure in reduction of fluid loss, especially in cases of non-infective diarrheas. Okay, so let's see what are the different anti-motility drugs we have. Okay, let's see what are the different anti-motility drugs we have. So let's talk about the first class of anti-motility drug we have is opioids. Okay, so this is the main class of anti-motility drugs. Let's see what are the drugs we have among opioid. The first drug we have among opioid is the most famous drug, that is loperamide. Okay, now what is loperamide? Loperamide is mu opioid agonist. Remember, opioid, they reduce motility of our intestine, so it stimulate mu receptor of opioid. But remember, it is non-addictive. As like opioid, it is non-addictive because it cannot cross blood-brain barrier. It cannot enter into the brain, hence it will not produce addiction. Because of this reason, this loperamide becomes the most commonly used drug for non-infective diarrhea. So it has become the drug of choice for diarrhea, which is seen in cases of irritable bowel syndrome. Irritable bowel syndrome diarrhea, it is the drug of choice. It is also the drug of choice for diarrhea, which is drug-induced diarrhea. Like, which drug may cause diarrhea? You can write 5-fluorouracil, one anti-cancer drug. You can also write irinotecan-induced diarrhea. Again, it is an anti-cancer drug. Okay? Now, remember, it can also be given as a short-term measure in cases of traveler's diarrhea. Okay? Traveler's diarrhea. Okay? But always it should be given along with antimicrobial. Now, if you talk about this loperamide is absolutely contraindicated in inflammatory bowel disease. Because in inflammatory bowel disease, there is lot of recurrent infections in the patient. And if there is infection, we don't want to suppress the motility of intestine. Inflammatory bowel disease, like ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, we should not be given. Okay, and it is contraindicated in children less than 2 years of age. Because in children less than 2 years of age, the blood-brain barrier is not fully formed. It can enter into the brain and it can cause respiratory depression. Okay, and it may cause a side effect known as toxic megacolon. As intestine is not contracting, the stretching, as the intestine is not contracting, the food will keep on stretching the intestine. The size of the intestine will become very large. It can lead to toxic megacolon. So this is the loperamide. Now, before loperamide, we were using a drug. Earlier, we were using a drug before loperamide. The drug was, still it is used in many places, that is diphenoxylate. Now, why diphenoxylate? Diphenoxylate is also mu opioid agonist. It also stimulates opioid receptor. But the point with diphenoxylate is addictive drug. It has lot of addiction. So it is an addictive drug. Loperamide is non-addictive. Diphenoxylate is an addictive drug. Okay, because it can cross into blood-brain barrier. So at that time, to reduce the addiction or abuse of diphenoxylate, we used to add atropine with diphenoxylate, because atropine will reduce the absorption of diphenoxylate into the blood. Okay, so at those time, to reduce the diphenoxylate abuse, we used to add atropine. Okay, so these are the opioid agonists. There are other drugs as well which are opioid agonists, but we will discuss them shortly. Okay,
So other drugs among opioid agonists, we can write those drugs as new drugs. So the first drug you can write is other drug. The third drug, so this was the second opioid, third we can write is diphenoxine. Diphenoxine is the active metabolite of diphenoxylate. It is the active metabolite. So everything is same like diphenoxylate. Everything is same like diphenoxylate. Fourth opioid we will be writing is eloxadoline. And esimadoline. Okay. Now these drugs are also mu plus kappa. Mu plus kappa agonist. But they are opioid has three receptor, but they are delta antagonist. They block delta receptor. So mu plus kappa agonist, delta agonist. So they are also anti-motility drug, where they are approved. They have been approved for diarrhea associated with irritable bowel syndrome, just like loperamide. Diarrhea associated with irritable bowel syndrome. So these are the drugs we have. Okay. Now the next class of drug we have, which is an anti-motility drug, we can write is perigoric. Perigoric. What is perigoric? Perigoric is camphorated opium tincture. So it is also a type of opium made in a tincture. It was used earlier for the treatment of diarrhea in children. Okay. Because tincture can be taken easily instead of a tablet. Okay, perigoric. So it is also a type of opium. So opioid, remember, are anti-motility drugs. Let's talk about now the next class of drug, that is anti-secretory drugs. Anti-secretory drugs. Okay, so let's talk about the first anti-secretory drugs we will write. So you can write a mnemonic. Okay. The first drug we have is resicadrotil. Resicadrotil is an enkephalinase inhibitor. Okay, enkephalinase inhibitor. So it will increase the level of enkephalins. And remember, enkephalins are the type of opioids only. But its main action is not in motility, it reduces the secretions in GIT. Okay, where data has been approved, resicadrotil has been approved for diarrhea. Okay, that is acute secretory diarrhea or acute diarrhea in children. It has been approved for acute diarrhea in children, especially secretory diarrheas, because they are secretory drug, anti-secretory drugs. Okay, the next drug you will write is Elocetron. Elocetron is 5-HT3 antagonist. It blocks serotonin receptor. Okay, where it has been used, it is used in diarrhea in irritable bowel syndrome. Diarrhea in irritable bowel syndrome. But you will write, it is only given in females. It is only given in females. And it is not given in males. It is not given in males. The reason is, first, it was found to be not effective in males. And the second point is, in males, it was causing ischemic colitis. It was causing severe damage of intestine to the male. So it's a very important part you must remember. Okay. Now you'll write bismuth subsalicylate. bismuth subsalicylate. Remember, bismuth compounds, as we have discussed in acid peptic disease chapter, bismuth compounds, they have antimicrobial property. Bismuth compound have been approved for the treatment of traveler's diarrhea. Okay, bismuth compounds have been approved for traveler's diarrhea. They have also been given in H. pylori induced peptic ulcers. Okay, H. pylori induced peptic ulcers. Next is, we will write A for, we give anti-muscarinic agent. Anti-muscarinics like atropine, hyoscine. Hyoscine, it comes with a brand name, that is Buscopan, hyoscine butylbromide. Okay, you can use other drugs like dicycloamine. Okay, now in which diarrhea they are given, remember acetylcholine, they will block acetylcholine receptors, and acetylcholine causes diarrhea. So they will block acetylcholine receptors. So where they are used, remember, they are the drug of choice for abdominal pain, which is known as abdominal colicky pain, which is associated with diarrhea. Hence they are known as antispasmodics. This atropine like drug, they are also given in nervousness induced diarrhea or nervousness associated diarrhea. Okay, now let's talk about O. O stands for octreotide. Now octreotide, it is a recombinant somatostatin hormone. Okay, it is a recombinant somatostatin hormone, and octreotide, it is the drug of choice for certain secretory diarrhea. Overall, if the word will come, the drug of choice for secretory diarrhea is octreotide. Now in which secretory diarrheas, we will write, it is the drug of choice for HIV induced, cancer induced diarrheas. It is the drug of choice for HIV induced and cancer induced diarrhea. It is also the drug of choice for post gastrectomy dumping syndrome. Okay, because as you have removed stomach, post gastrectomy means you have removed stomach. When a person will eat something, the food will not get absorbed easily. The osmotic pressure of food will lead to diarrhea, and there will be electrolyte imbalance also. Post gastrectomy dumping syndrome, drug of choice is octreotide, and it is also the drug of choice for tumor associated diarrhea like carcinoid tumor. Okay, carcinoid tumors, here the level of serotonin increases, and VIPoma, vasoactive intestinal peptide. So in all these diarrheas, the drug of choice is octreotide. Now remember, we have made a new drug. That drug has been made for HIV induced diarrhea. That drug name is crofelemer. The new drug for HIV induced diarrhea is crofelemer. Crofelemer has recently been approved for HIV induced diarrhea. The reason is, crofelemer, remember, it inhibits CFTR receptor. CFTR stand for cystic fibrosis transmembrane receptor, and it reduces the secretion of various ions. It acts as an anti-secretory. Okay, but the drug of choice for HIV induced diarrhea is octreotide. A new drug has been made, that is crofelemer. Crofelemer is the new drug for HIV induced diarrhea. Okay, now these are the drugs which are anti-secretory drugs. Okay, these are the drugs which are anti-secretory. So let's talk about now the last class of anti-diarrheal drugs, that is adsorbents. Now what adsorbents will do, suppose this is the intestine and the fluid is passing very highly. adsorbent, what they will do, they will increase the stool consistency. They will go, they will increase in the bulk, and remember, they will improve stool consistency. Hence, the patient who will pass now the stool will have less amount of water. So, the stools will become hard, okay, because in diarrhea there is loose stools. So, what are the drugs? The first drug we have is prebiotics. They are also known as dietary fibers. So, we have already written the names of those drugs, okay. We have already written the names of those drugs. Let's see those drugs and we will write out here again. So, I think we have written out here prebiotics. The name of the drugs are bran, husk, mitomycin. Okay, so let's talk about these drugs, prebiotics. So these are the drugs. Now, remember these drugs, what they will, how do they will produce their action? Remember, these drugs are also known as bulk laxatives. Although they are named as laxative, but remember they are used in the treatment of diarrhea as well as constipation both. They are given in the treatment of diarrhea and they are given in the treatment of constipation both. Now, why they are given in the treatment of diarrhea? Because when the fluid is passing uselessly, water is passing uselessly, these bulk laxative, they have a property that they adsorb water on their surface. So, they will adsorb water on their surface and the bulk will increase. And as the bulk will increase, they will pass out in the stools very slowly. Because of this reason, there will be improve in stool consistency. They will stick water on their surface, which is passing out in urine. And why they are used in constipation? Because when their bulk is increased, they put pressure on intestinal muscle. Intestinal contraction occurs, increases in constipation. They improve intestinal contraction. Okay, they improve intestinal contraction. And we have already reduced, so why they are used in diarrhea? They adsorb water. Why they are used in constipation? Because they improve intestinal contraction. And they have a very great advantage, they are prebiotics. Prebiotics means they increase the growth of good bacterias. They increase the growth of good bacterias. So, where they are used, remember, these drugs, they have become now the drug of choice for the treatment of IBS, irritable bowel syndrome. Okay, and this psyllium or mitomycin, remember, it is the drug of choice in pregnancy for the treatment of constipation as well as diarrhea both. Okay, so it is the drug of choice for the treatment of constipation in pregnancy, mitomycin or psyllium. Okay, so this is adsorbent. Now, the last class of adsorbent, we have one more drug we have among adsorbent, that is bile acid sequestrant. They are also known as bile acid binders and they are also known as resins. These drugs we have already discussed under a chapter known as hypolipidemics. Okay, hypolipidemics. Now, first let's write the names of the drugs, then I'll explain you what is the mechanism. The first drug is cholestyramine. Cholestipol. So they will start with the word col and colicevelam. Okay. Now, what is the function? Suppose this is GIT and we know from liver bile is secreted into our GIT. Now, what is the function of bile? The function of bile is to reabsorb fats into the intestine. Now, remember, all of this bile, around 95% of this bile gets reabsorbed back into the liver by enterohepatic reabsorption. By enterohepatic reabsorption. Okay, so these drugs, what they will do, they will go and they will bind with the bile. When they will go and bind with the bile, this bile will be ejected out in feces. Okay, they will be ejected out in feces. So their enterohepatic circulation will not occur. So what will happen now? They will produce a paradoxical effect. This liver will stop secreting bile. So because of this reason, the liver will stop secreting bile. So where these drugs are used? These drugs, they are used in the treatment of biliary diarrhea. Okay, they are used for the treatment of biliary diarrhea because they are bile acid binders. Okay, they will bind with this bile acid. Remember, they are also used in biliary gastritis if this bile is moving upwards, or biliary esophagitis if this bile is coming to stomach or intestine. Okay, now remember, these drugs, they are also used, these drugs, they are also used as a hypolipidemic drugs. Okay, because bile contains cholesterol, they reduce the level of cholesterol or LDL level in the blood. So they are also used in hypolipidemics as a hypolipidemics. So please refer to the videos of hypolipidemics for their great detail about these drugs. Okay, hypolipidemics, they are also used in the treatment of pruritus in cirrhosis of liver. Why they are used in the pruritus in cirrhosis of liver? Because in liver cirrhosis, this bile, it gets accumulated in the body, it is not secreted into the blood, and this bile, when precipitates in the body, if it precipitates on the skin, it can lead to pruritus. So these are the drugs we have for the treatment of diarrhea. Okay, these are the drugs we have for the treatment of diarrhea. So before ending this part, let's see the treatment of a disease in which diarrhea and constipation is very common. Let's see the treatment of a disease known as irritable bowel syndrome. Okay, let's see the treatment or the drugs for irritable bowel syndrome. So irritable bowel syndrome, remember, the patient can present to you with three things. The patient will tell you a typical history that my stomach or GIT remain upset. It remains upset. Okay, and if you'll ask the history, the patient will tell you that I have a very prolonged episodes of mild diarrheas, which is known as diarrhea predominant IBS. That from many months I am suffering from diarrhea, but the diarrhea is very mild. I am able to do my work, and sometimes I feel constipated from many months, constipation predominant IBS. And sometimes the patient will tell you that I have a lot of abdominal pain, abdominal cramps, which is known as abdominal spasm. So we have to take care of all these features of irritable bowel syndrome. Okay, we have to take care features of all these conditions of irritable bowel syndrome. So let's see how to treat diarrhea predominant IBS. Okay, diarrhea predominant. Now in diarrhea predominant IBS, remember, diarrhea predominant IBS will start with a drug that is bulk laxatives. Even in constipation predominant IBS, we start with bulk laxatives, because bulk laxatives, they are used in both diarrhea as well as constipation. Okay, if it is not responsive, start with an anti-diarrheal drug. That anti-diarrheal drug is loperamide, that is opioid agonist, hai na, opioid. If it is still not controlled, start with elocetron. Elocetron, we have seen, NR means no response. Elocetron was 5-HT3 antagonist, so it is only used in women's. Okay, in constipation predominant IBS, we start with bulk laxative. If it is still not responsive, you can start with an osmotic laxative, that is polyethylene glycol. polyethylene glycol. So here we are giving antidiarrheal drugs. For treatment of constipation, we are giving laxatives. So please refer to the videos of laxative. Still, if it is not responsive, we can give clonidine. Okay, clonidine. If it is still not responsive, we can give chloride secretors. I'm really sorry, please remove this part, clonidine. Okay, please write here chloride secretors. Chloride secretors, the drug word lubiprostone, linaclotide or plicanatide. So here then we will give chloride secretors. Okay, in diarrhea predominant you can add clonidine. Here you can write clonidine. Clonidine also reduces the motility of intestine. Okay, in the treatment of abdominal pain we give antimuscarinic drugs. Antimuscarinics like buscopan or hyoscine, atropine, atropine, etc. You can also use TCA. TCA is tricyclic antidepressants, because tricyclic antidepressants also have antimuscarinic action. Okay, tricyclic antidepressants. So this is the treatment of irritable bowel syndrome. Okay, this is the treatment of irritable bowel syndrome, and this completes our drugs for diarrhea also. So thank you very much.